Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank Professor Azam and the organizing committee for inviting me here to this wonderful session. It's always good to be back to my Praner Dhaka. I was born and raised here. I went to Dhaka Medical College. So I think one of the main interesting things of programs like this is not only to learn together, but also to see my friends and colleagues. So this is really what we call a Milan Mela and Praner Mela. So it's very wonderful to be here. Thank you for having me here. We are going to talk in the next 10 minutes about challenges of thrombus burden. My previous two speakers sort of touched base on those things already. I'm going to go into a little more details. One thing I'd like to definitely mention is that we had amazing progress in the field of cardiology in Bangladesh over the last 15 to 20 years. The credit goes to our senior professors and also to the young budding cardiologists who are really, you know, thriving in their field. So my talk is really focused to them. And you know, I've been in practice for 16 years, but I'm still learning every day. So I'm gonna share some experience with you. So let's start with this case. First of all, I have no disclosures. So it's 2 o'clock in the morning and you're doing primary PCI. I know in Bangladesh, you're doing more and more primary PCI. So you'll be facing this kind of situations. So a 65-year-old male develops acute chest pain, has history of hypertension, hyperlipidemia and smoking. And this is his ECG. So you can clearly see there is an inferior STEMI. So you decide to take the patient to the cath lab. And this is the first shot. So the next question is, how do you approach this problem? So normally you want to pass a wire. That's the first thing. And then with the first injection, this is what you see. Or maybe a case like this, and you pass a wire, and you clearly see this thrombus or possibly a dissection. So that's the first question you ask yourself. Did I dissect that vessel with my wire? Or is this a true thrombus to begin with? Or did I cause the dissection that caused the thrombus? So for the fellows, for the junior cardiologist, if you could punch in the answer, what would you do next? Again, this is 2 o'clock in the morning. You're by yourself with some juniors. Balloon angioplasty, direct stenting, manual thrombus extraction with export or pronto, or you or use a mechanical thrombus extraction with penumbra. Can you punch in the, can we have that audience response thing? Azam, are we having that thing live or no? So this is, these are the, if we could punch in, we could see, you know, what people answer. Or you can just, one of the juniors can stand up and tell me what you would like to do. Anybody? Any volunteer? There is, honestly, there is no right and wrong answer to this. I mean, anything could be your approach and that could be the right approach. It depends on the situation. Any volunteers?
We can go for, I mean, if there is a distal flow is established, or you can go for the direct stenting, one option. And if there is a no distal flow, we can put the pediatric balloon. We can pass dotting the balloon to see if there is a decision flag or not, or a thrombus. If thrombus and no distal flow, then we can pre-dilate the lesion. Then we can go for, and if it is, still there is a heavy thrombus, we can use the penumbra device.
Okay, so that's Dr. Arifin's approach. Anybody else has a different approach? So let's talk about this. And again, there is no right or wrong about these things. So what happens when you have a thrombus? You know, you have a plaque which could be not necessarily 80%, 90% thing. And for many of even our young cardiologists, there is a misconception. Most of our MIs actually happen when the blockage is less than 50%. So you have a plaque rupture, and what happens, you have blood clot forming in that vessel, and the platelet aggregating factors makes more angry platelets, you form a clot, and that occludes the vessels, and you have an MI, right? So this is a thrombogenic milieu, and that's why it has to be very important that you anticoagulate this patient's well to stop the propagation of the thrombus. So this is what you see in OCT. You see the thrombus like this. And we already have mentioned, my previous speakers have mentioned, that when you see a thrombus, there is a problem. The prognosis is poor. So that increases the chance of stent thrombosis. So you put a stent and there is increased chance that that stent is going to thrombose now or later. There is distal embolization. So the thrombus burden goes downstream and causes myocardial damage, like microvascular damage. And that causes both in-hospital poor outcome and long-term poor outcome. So this is not a good situation, but we have to come out of it, right? So the next question is, once you're tackling this thing from your technical aspect, what are the pharmacological things that we cannot forget at the same time? So what will you start? Again, any volunteers? from the juniors. Heparin alone, heparin plus GP2B3A, or bivalirudin, which is we call Angiomax in USA.
Option two.
Okay, that's wonderful. So that's what I would prefer. Normally, you know, even in USA, we're moving away. So in the beginning, we started with heparin many years ago. Then we sort of started heparin plus GP2B3A. Then we kind of moved away from GP2B3A. Then came the era of bivalirudin or Angiomax. But now we are back to circle back to heparin alone. In most cases, even for STEMIs and non-STEMIs, we're just using heparin. But when you have a high thrombus burden, that's a wonderful answer. Thank you so much. We do use GP2B3A in those heavy thrombus burden cases. So don't forget that, because once you're fixing that blockage, if you do not use GP2B3A along with heparin, you can run into more trouble. So the pharmacological approach is, of course, you have to load them with aspirin 325, not long term. Long term is always the low dose aspirin, but short term, the beginning, you have load them with 325. You used the P2Y12, which is the clopidogrel or the ticagrelor or the prasugrel. We mostly use clopidogrel or ticagrelor in this case, actually. Heparin, and keep the ACT above 250. And GP2B3A is just we like talked about. And this is the sort of the angry platelets we talked about. I'm not going to go into the details for the sake of time, but essentially GP2B3A is inhibiting the platelet aggregation, so reducing the thrombus burden. All right, so the other problem that you run, and I'll show you in my case, hopefully I'll get time to show you my case, that these thrombus burden are associated with spasm. So suddenly you put a stent or you balloon it and this whole vessel can spasm on you, completely shut down. You have a wire down, but you don't see anything else. But you know, just a few minutes ago, you could see the vessel. So you can use nitroglycerin, you can use nipride, you can use adenosine or calcium channel blocker. We usually use nicardipine a lot. So we talked about the two options of the mechanical approach. You can use a Pronto or Export, which is essentially a big syringe, and you just suck out the clot, and you have the distal end, the catheter in the distal to the clot, and this is what you see when you suck it out. But the question is, you know, where is the data? So the TAPAS trial initially started it and showed some positive results. So there was a lot of excitement about the thrombus extraction with manual devices. But when we had the total and the TASTE trial, that it really did not show any difference. As a matter of fact, the total trial showed increased stroke risk with the mechanical thrombus extraction. So based on this, this is the meta-analysis showing the same thing that I just mentioned. So based on this, the American College of Cardiology guidelines changed, and they made routine thrombus extraction for MIs at class 3, meaning like you cannot use it routinely. So it's a 2B indication, meaning like in certain cases, when you have a huge thrombus burden, you may use it with weak data. But now we have a little bit more advanced device, which is called the Penumbra, which is essentially the same thing. You have the catheter at the thrombus thing, and there's a device like this. The machine continuously sucks the thrombus out instead of having the syringe. So the trial is the CHEETAH trial that was initially presented at TCT in 2021, and it was published in Circulation just a few months ago in February 2023. So it was done on 400 patients. It showed lower MACE rates, better flow restoration, and it was a safe trial. So based on this, Circulation said that this is encouraging data, but definitely needs more study. So AngioJet was previously used. We didn't show any positive results, so we don't use AngioJet anymore. I'm not going to go into details of that. So my previous speaker also mentioned about deferred stenting. So this is one of the strategies some centers take, or depending on the cardiologist. So what is deferred stenting? When you are trying to put a stent in an acute situation, it is hard to assess the true size of the vessels because of the vasospasm. Even if you do an IVUS, you may not be able to assess the true size. So your stent may be undersized. So you can just leave these patients, put a balloon and put them on heparin and 2B3A and wait, you know, 48, 72 hours, and then bring them back and put the stent. That is called the deferred stenting method. The problem with that is if that vessel can occlude while the patient is waiting to be stented, so that can cause more trouble. So intracoronary thrombolytics can be used in some centers in USA and Europe. They use it. They just inject. You have a catheter, you know, up to the vessel and inject thrombolytic. And in some studies showed some improved STEMI float grade, improved myocardial blush grade, decreased hospital mortality, and no major bleeding event. We, in our particular center, do not use it on a routine basis. So post-PCI is very important to use the aspirin indefinitely, the 81 or 75, which is available in Bangladesh. And you can consider DAPT beyond a year, which we usually stop within a year. So in my personal practice, you take like a shared decision making. If it's a young patient with no bleeding problem, I continue the DAPT beyond a year if the patient agrees with that. So this is the result, and you can see you can have a good result. And I think I have 2 minutes to show my case. But before that, essentially this take home message is there is no strong data or specific guidelines for heavy thrombus burden in STEMI. You can consider using GP2B3A and consider mechanical thrombus aspiration. And we have to be aware that this patient regardless will have bad outcome. And you can consider long-term DAPT. And finally, medicine is not only science, it's also an art. So use your judgment based on your case and your situation. So if I have time, can I just quickly show the case? I think I have 2 minutes. I'm just gonna quickly go over the case. This is actually a real case. So 54-year-old patient with history of diabetes, hypertension, hyperlipidemia. He's a construction worker, he's a smoker, had chest pain at work, dropped down. His colleagues brought him to the hospital. They did CPR, they intubated him. In the ER, he had cardiac arrest 2 times. And again, it was the middle of the night of the case. We activated our cath lab. And this is the first shot. You can see, and we were able to wire it down. I put the wire down there and balloon it. I used a JR4 guide. I used a guideliner for better support. So you can see the huge thrombus burden there. And then the question is this like a wire in a dissection plane or a thrombus? Probably a thrombus. I think we just wanted to make sure. So I put first a PT2 wire. Then I put another like a run through wire in the RPDA just to make sure. We balloon it. And of course the vessel now shuts down on me because there is another thrombus. So we used, I used a penumbra here before this to suction the clot. So at this point we used nicardipine and ballooned it again. And you can see then we put a 4-0 stent. We did post dilatation and this was the end result. So this is, pretty much the case that I wanted to show you, but if you have any questions, I'll answer at the end. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.